My screen is okay, Vandana.
Yeah.
Good.
Yes, you can start.
Screen is okay, Vandana. Yeah. My screen is okay, Vandana.
Yeah.
Good. Good afternoon, everyone. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Aditi Sengde for the special evening lecture today. Good afternoon, everyone. It is my pleasure to introduce. Good afternoon, everyone. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Aditi Sengde. Aditi, for the special lecture today, Aditi is currently a professor at Harish Chandra Research Institute in Prayagraj, which was earlier known as Allahabad. Aditi received her master's degree in 1997 from University of Calcutta, and then she went to Poland to the University of Gdansk to do her PhD. After her PhD, Aditi won a very, very prestigious Humboldt Research Fellowship. She went to Hanover, Germany to do her postdoctoral fellowship in Leibniz University. And after that, she joined Barcelona, the Institute of Photonic Sciences, ICFO. Aditi returned to India in 2008, and she briefly joined Jawaharlal Nehru University for 1 year as assistant professor. And then in 2009, Aditi went to Harish Chandra Research Institute, HRI. And Aditi has started her own quantum information and computational group at HRI, along with two more colleagues. And she has guided several PhD students and published more than 100 research papers in peer-reviewed journals. And I'm extremely, extremely proud to tell all of you that Aditi got the highest recognition in sciences, which is called Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in 2018. And she's the first woman scientist to get this award in physics. And this is really a very, very, a highest honor award for any scientist, and I'm really filled with pride. And without taking much of your time, I would request Aditi to start her lecture on quantum technologies. And to you, Aditi.
Yeah, thank you very much, Poonam. So let me share the screen. So, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so now I make it full screen. So it's visible, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm starting. So good afternoon, everyone. It's really a pleasure to be part of this Vigyan Vidushi program. Because this is a very nice effort from TFR. So when I actually received the email from Vandana, so I was very happy and I accepted immediately. So today I'm going to talk, as Poonam said, and thank you very much, Poonam, for the introduction. I work on technologies. So in particular, I work on quantum technologies. So the technologies that are built by using quantum mechanics. So before starting my topic, the research topic that I'm working on, let me tell you very briefly my journey towards my research career. So I studied in two schools, which are quite well known in Calcutta, and they are both girls' school. Then I moved to a college, which is also a women college, Bethune College. And these three institutions helped me a lot to shape or to develop my characteristics, what I am today. And in all these places, all the teachers were women. So in some sense, they have motivated me to do my career in academia. I met several good teachers, and during my school times, I really wanted to become a teacher like them. And also in this respect, I should mention that I have also a very supportive role from my parents. My mother was a teacher. I also attended her class and I really liked and so on. But when I moved to the university, in University of Calcutta, I saw that the picture is quite different, because among our 40, 45 students class, there are only 6 students who were girls. And then among 20 to 25 faculty members, 3 were the women faculty. But I think later on, even when I went abroad, I found that I was the only female faculty, female PhD students in the University of Gdansk in theoretical physics. There were some experimentalists. So what I understand that okay, although the number was few, but we had I had a good opportunity to talk with my supervisors, who helped me a lot in a sense that to motivate me to do my research. Later on, during my postdocs also, I was able to work with a very famous women scientist, and I collaborated a lot. We have a lot of discussion. And I think the picture is now changing slowly, but as I think Shobhana has told in her talk, that we should keep fighting. So I hope that the students who are involved in this Vigyan Vidushi program, we will see all of them in near future in some PhD program. So with this, I maybe I will go to my topic of research, which I work on. For some reason, actually, it's very slow when I go to the next slide. So I'm sorry. But,
It's not moving. You can go out and come back again.
Yeah, I think it's not moving.
So you can just start sharing again.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So if I talk about technologies, then technologies can be broadly classified into 2 categories. One is computer, which we use every day, like desktop, laptop, iPad, etc. Then there are communication devices, which actually help us to connect with each other. They too are also somehow related, because for example, when we use internet to send some email, we either use desktop, laptop, or in nowadays mobile phones. So now these communication devices are also can be divided broadly into 2 categories. One is communication without security. That means there is no lock and key required to store information or to send information. For example, the informations that we get via in newspaper or in some internet news channel, there is no security required. This is also true when we talk with our friends, that also doesn't require security. However, there are certain communications which require actually security, and this is well known. This field is called cryptography. And there we need somehow lock to protect the information. And for example, this we use commonly in internet banking, and it also has some application in national security. So what I'm going to talk in next 40 minutes or so, that if we build quantum version of these technologies, they will be more efficient than their classical counterparts. So let's start with the computational issues. So let's start that what are the quantum compute, if we build quantum computer, what are the advantages that we will get? So the computer that we use nowadays, that desktop laptop, that I will call classical computer, because this is based on something called classical information theory. Now we know that these computers that we nowadays are using are very useful, which are from hospitals to the government offices, marketing, etc. And in this pandemic situations, probably we understand that they also play an important role in the common educations like school or college education. So these computers are used to write, for example, documents. We can use internet via this computer, but at the same time, these computers also can solve certain mathematical problems. So doing some mathematical problems, we can also use computer. We can write some program to solve certain mathematical problems. So let us consider. So before I talk about the a certain mathematical problem, let us talk about the basic unit that classical computer use. This is called bit. So this is one of the zero or one. Now, how the basic principles of classical computer work. So we have some input, which actually we write in bits. So in terms of zeros and ones, then classical computer performs certain logic gates operations and give us the output. So these are the steps that we can think of. So we have input, then the manipulations happen by using this logical gates, and we finally get some output. Let us now consider certain problem which we can solve by using our normal desktop or laptop. So the first problem that I'm going to discuss is the prime identification problem. So suppose I give you a number and you have to tell me whether it is prime or not. Now, if I talk about up to 100, then easily you know what are the prime numbers. So here I marked it with red circles. Now, if I go on, I can also easily, or not easily, but I can write, I can find out what are the prime numbers if I consider up to 1000. Now, suppose I give you a 10-digit number. Here, actually, I type it randomly, this 10-digit. Except I was careful that the last digit should be odd, because if it is even, then we know that it can be divisible by two. And so immediately we can understand they are not prime numbers. So here this is I typed, and then I find out just by using a simple program that it is divisible by seven. So it is not a prime number. So the question that we want to ask in general, that can we design a program in a computer which can solve any n digit number and can tell us at the end whether a number is prime or not? Now, although this question looks so simple, but the point is it's not so simple to solve for any n digit number. And in 2002, in members of IIT Kanpur faculty, and that time they were PhD students, solved that they proposed an algorithm by which one can solve this problem with polynomial time. I'm not going to discuss about what is polynomial time. You can think that it is a reasonable time. So if you have an n digit number, I'll be able to solve it at something like order of n to the power alpha, say n square and so on. So I have to write a program which can give me an answer within the n squared time or n time or something. So this is what I mean by polynomial time. So this was solved, and these are the three people who solved it. And so this is a good news that we can solve this problem in our normal computer. Now, the second problem that I'm going to discuss is the finding prime factors of an integer. So this is known as prime factorization problem. So in this scenario, I will be given an integer, say 45, and I want to know the prime factors of an integer. So in case of 45, I know what are the prime factors. Now, if I give you 72 also, you can tell me what is the prime factors. Now, suppose I give you a bigger number. So this is an 8-digit number. Then you need some time to tell me all the factors, but still you can find it. Now, again, ask the same question that if I give you an 8-digit number, how much time it will take to tell me all the prime factors of that integer. Now it's known, you can find it if you Google it, that you will be able to find this table, that if you have a 129 digit, for example, then there are 1600 very powerful quantum, powerful classical computers if you use, then it almost takes 8 months in general. And if you have 250 digit and similar number of workstations working, then actually it almost requires the age of the universe. That means with the, if we increase the number of digits, then it's the normal computer that we have now, even the most powerful computer can take, actually takes exponential number of steps. So it's almost impossible, we can say. So here I must stress that up to today, all the algorithms which are known, that takes exponential of n steps. In particular, if you want to know exactly what do I mean by exponential of n steps. So if you have an n digit number, it takes this many steps. So it's almost impossible by using normal computer if we increase the number of digits. So till today, there is no classical algorithm available which can solve. However, importantly, in 1994, Peter Schur has shown that if you use quantum mechanics, then you can solve this problem in polynomial time. And this is known as a Schur's algorithm. And after this paper, so this is Peter Schur. So after this paper or during this time, there are other algorithms which were proposed to solve certain other mathematical problems. And in all these problems, it was shown that quantum mechanics can help to reduce steps. So what will be the basic unit if we want to build quantum computer? It is known as qubit. So it's a quantum bit. So QU stand for quantum and bit for bit. And what is quantum bit? It is just an arbitrary spinor particle. So it is an arbitrary two-dimensional quantum system, can be called a quantum bit. So this will be the basic unit if we want to build a quantum computer. It is similar like the bit that one uses in a classical computer. So if I think about spinor particles, then this is the up spin and this is the down spin. And this is an arbitrary quantum state in a two-dimensional Hilbert space, complex Hilbert space, where we have the normalization conditions and this is the normalization condition. Pictorially, if we can think that this alpha up plus beta down actually stays in the block sphere. So this is the sphere. The surface of the sphere, so all the points in the surface of the sphere actually represents this arbitrary two-dimensional quantum state. Here, the poles are represented by up and down spin. Now, here, I just want to mention that this discovery of Peter Schur and other scientists show that there is a revolution in technology. So for example, I mean, this is this slide. I would like to thank Shogini Ghosh because this was one of our talk which motivated me to prepare this slide. So the If you build better and better lamps or candles, that cannot lead to the electric bulb or LED lamp. Similarly, if we build better and better computer, classical computer, we cannot reach to a quantum computer. So we have to use quantum mechanics. So the basic principles in which computer has to be built, that will be different in classical computer and the quantum computer. So there is a revolution in technology with these discoveries. And there are a lot of progress in these directions, experimental progress. So this is the timeline that was published by USA, where they more or less planned that how different quantum technologies can be built over time. And there are several technological giants like Google, IBM, Microsoft, and there are others who are involved to build a quantum computer. It's already, if you look, that there are 5-qubit quantum computer, which one can use if you search in a web. There are also, up to today, Google 72-qubit chip are also available, and there are other number of qubits. So it's not only the theoretical discovery, it's already in reality. People are trying to build a computer which are more involving more and more qubits. To show really the advantage of quantum computer, we need to build almost 1,000-qubit quantum computer. So if you are interested, you can find, I have put several links which you can use to look into the development. Okay, now I move to the communication devices. I will briefly outline some of the issues here. So as I said, that communication devices can be with and without security. And so we know all the communication devices nowadays we use, for example, mobile phone, there are Kindle and etc. In old times, people use, for example, parrots to send information, or even the newspapers, which we still use, but maybe nowadays most of us use the news channels or internet newspaper, e-version of the newspaper. So if you want to design any communication protocol that involve at least two parties, one I call Alice, another is Bob. Now, similarly like what now I am communicating with you. So you people are situated in different locations and I am in Allahabad or Prayagraj. So this is a way to communicate information. So Alice, so any communication protocol should involve at least two parties, which the protocol that I am talking or I am interested in, where the two parties are situated in two different locations. For example, one in Allahabad, another can be in Kolkata or Mumbai or any other places. And so they are not together. This is what I want to stress. And suppose Alice is the sender and Bob is the receiver. And so these two can be also sender and receiver. And the aim is to send some information from Alice to Bob. Now, as I said, that the information can be classical or quantum. So classical means that informations which can be translated in bits, which is one of the zeros and one. And quantum information means, I mean quantum state. So for example, it can be qubit or a spin one state or in higher dimensional state. So something quantum state. And the aim is for sender to send this classical or quantum information to Bob or the receiver. Now, secure communication means that there will be an eavesdropper between Alice and Bob, and this eavesdropper aim is to gather as much information as possible that Alice is sending to Bob. Now, in quantum communication, there can be shown that if you use quantum mechanical principles, then you can actually send more classical information, or you can encode classical information in a smaller subsystems. For example, if we consider a communications protocol by using quantum mechanics, one can show the following things. So for example, suppose my task is to send 2 bits of classical information to Bob. Now one can show that if we don't use quantum mechanics, then I require 4-dimensional space. That means I require 4 distinguishable objects. Say for example, 4 colors of ball or 4 colors of flowers and so on. On the other hand, if I use quantum mechanics, then to send these 2 bits of classical information, one requires only 2-dimensional space. So this is the advantage that you can get, and that's why it's called dense coding. So the 2 bits of information can be encoded in a smaller subsystem. So this is about a classical information transmission. Now, we can, by using quantum mechanics, this was shown that you can double the capacity of information transmission. Now, there is a similar advantage one can get if one uses quantum mechanics to send quantum state, that is qubit. And this was known as quantum teleportation, was discovered by these 6 people. Now, the task here is to send an arbitrary quantum state from Alice to Bob. Now, it was shown that if we don't use quantum mechanics, then or if we don't use a special quantum state that I will be talking in a minute, then we actually need infinite amount of classical bits to send arbitrary 2-dimensional quantum state. On the other hand, if we use quantum mechanical principles, then 2 bits of classical communication is enough to send an arbitrary quantum state from one place to another. So here we see that quantum mechanics can help to infinitely gain, or the efficiency can be enhanced infinitely. Now, what is the special kind of state that one uses for sending this quantum bit? And this is known as theory of entanglement. If you are interested, you can look in the review papers that I have mentioned here. So this is one picture actually drawn by one of our students to tell about what is entanglement. It's nicely represented in this review article that we wrote recently, but I will not get time to discuss in detail. So again, to talk about entanglement, we need at least two parties. Suppose Alice and Bob. And suppose Alice and Bob are separated, situated in 2 distant locations. For example, here I put Mumbai and Allahabad. And suppose Alice prepares a quantum state and Bob prepares another quantum state. Then the joint state can be represented in a tensor product Hilbert space. So this looks like that. Now, the states that Alice and Bob can prepare, even when they are situated in distant locations, are called unentangled states, and they are actually useless states. So by these states, or by sharing these quantum mechanical states, quantum teleportations cannot be performed, or the advantage that we talk about cannot be obtained. However, if Alice and Bob can prepare an entangled state, which cannot be written like that, or in other words, to prepare an entangled state, Alice and Bob's particle should interact. So Alison Bob will not be able to prepare these states when they are situated in two distant locations. So one of the example is the famous singlet state, where here I again represented by spin-ha particles. These are the up spin of, for example, a sigma z direction. So this is the up eigenvector, you can think, and this is the down one. And a possible scheme to prepare an entangled state is the following. There will be a source which prepare an entangled state, then send one particle to Alice and another particle to Bob, who are situated in two distant locations. And finally, Alice and Bob share an entangled state. Now you can generalize this to also to an arbitrary quantum state. So this definition that I have talked about is for PO states, but in experiments, we usually get mixed states, and there also you can define. But here one point I want to stress that it's not easy. Although the definition is easy to give, but given a state, it is not easy to detect entangled state till today. So there is no efficient criteria known by which one can detect entangled states in laboratory as well as in theoretically. Now, when we talk about two spin-ha particles, you can actually detect, there is a mathematical efficient criteria, and one can also quantify. I will use some entanglement measure, or I will quantify entanglement by using something called logarithmic negativity. But I'm not going into detail. If you are interested, we can discuss this. You can send me your questions. I can answer by email and so on. Now, in both the protocol that I have talked about, this quantum dense coding, quantum teleportation, one can show these entangled states will be the resource. So entanglement can be used as a resource to achieve this goal or the quantum advantage. Now, this is also not only theoretical results, but there are some experimental demonstration. So for example, there's a beautiful experiment done in China where they use photons, the polarization degrees of freedom of photon, and they're able to create this entangled photon state in satellite. Then they send, so this satellite can be thought of as a source, and from there they send two particles to two distant locations, and these two cities are 1200 kilometers away. And they performed some communications task, and this was led by Pan. And this is a big achievement in this quantum communication area. There are also, so just to give you the advantage, to show the advantage, so the quantum communication protocol can be performed over, say, 1200 kilometers. So for example, between Ahmedabad and Hyderabad, if you choose. Now there are other physical systems which are also useful to demonstrate entangled state. For example, if you have an ion trap, the internal levels of ions can act as qubit, and people who are able to entangle up to 20 qubit, and till today this is the maximum number that I know. There are other potential physical systems in which entangled states can be created, and all the protocols that I have described, the computation and the communication protocols, can be realized. For example, ultra-cold atoms in optical lattice, NMR, nuclear magnetic resonances, and probably everybody is now talking about superconducting qubits, by which this 70 two qubits quantum computer has been demonstrated. Now, the main goal in this area is to find a proper physical system where the quantum computer can be built. And in these directions, we also work, although I'm a theoretician, so I work from the theoretical point of view. So as I said, finding a physical system in which quantum computer or quantum communication protocols is important. And this is one of the challenge. And we are working on that direction. So now in next 10 minutes or so, I will present some of the work that we are doing at HRI. So as I said, that in all these protocols, entangled states are important. They are the important resource to achieve the goal. So this is towards that directions, the main outline of my talk, which will be mainly focusing my work or the work that we are performing at HRI. So I will talk about some quantum spin models, and I will show you that there are important fundamental questions that can be answered or that can be addressed by using quantum information quantities. And I will also talk about a dynamical or dynamics of quantum states. And I will show that the entanglement can be a useful quantity to detect certain interesting or counterintuitive phenomena. So these are the mostly the work that I'm just going to present very briefly. So the work, these are the review papers in which you can look, and some of the our works and the works around the world are you can find in this review paper. So the work that I'm going to present are actually, there are several people involved. So here I, all are my, these are my PhD students. Amit is a postdoc, Ujjal is a faculty. They were involved in the in this work that I'm going to present. They have they all have left for postdoctoral positions. Currently, I should say these are the people who are now working in this area, which help which I'm going to present. So let's talk about the quantum spin model. So why is it interesting, or why should we study quantum spin model in the in this quantum information and computation field? So as I said, there can be a fundamental questions which can be addressed by using concept from quantum information theory. For example, the quantum phase transition, thermal property, out of equilibrium, and so on. But there are also another important application that one can, as I have already discussed. So these quantum spin model can be important systems which can be realized in ultra-cold atoms, iron traps, and so on. And so these quantum spin model can be a potential candidate for realizing quantum computer. So I will just discuss the one of the basic model that we were working on. So this is a N spin hub particle, interacting spin hub particle. And they follow the periodic boundary conditions. That means one is connected to N. So this is like a chain. So this I mean by periodicity. And this N spin hub particles follow this Hamiltonian. And this is known as XY quantum spin model. The sigmas are the Pauli spin operator. Sigma x is the x Pauli spin operator. And these h is the strength of the magnetic field. J is the coupling constant. Gamma is the anisotropy parameter. So when gamma equal to one, we get the Ising model. Now we know that if you consider a zero temperature state, this model is the simplest model which undergoes a quantum phase transition from antiferromagnetic to paramagnetic or ferromagnetic to the paramagnetic one, depending on the sign of J. Now, this phase transition can be detected by using several well-known method like correlation length, and there are other ways. Now, what it was shown around 2000 that entanglement can also detect this quantum phase transition. Now, what is this entanglement? Entanglement means I calculate the this is a n spin Hamiltonian. I can find out the ground state or the zero temperature state of that model, which will be an n party state. Now, if I trace out this, all the parties except say these two, so this is this rho 2, 3, and I calculate entanglement, then I can show that entanglement can change its behavior near quantum phase transition. Although this figure cannot show that what changes it happens, but if you take a derivative of entanglement, then you will see that at lambda equal to 1, where there is a quantum phase transition, this derivative shows a kink at quantum phase transition point. So we find that two-site entanglement can detect quantum phase transition in these spin models. Now, this also has been done experimentally, for example, by using polarization degrees of freedom of photons, spin models are created. There are also in ion trap, they are able to create this, realize this quantum spin model. And recent development on polar molecules also give us a possibility to create quantum spin models in polar molecules. Now, what we have studied in where we change a quantum XY spin model to an alternating field quantum XY spin model, which we call ATXY model. Here, the interacting term remains as it is, but the magnetic field term changes. So here we put that in all odd side, the strength of the magnetic field is H1 minus H2. On the other hand, the strength of the magnetic field in the even side is H1 plus H2. And if I put H2 equal to 0, I will get back the quantum XY model that I have just discussed. Now, why do I consider this model? Now, the point that we show, first of all, this model can also be realized in ultracold atoms, C9 traps. The important point is that this ATXY spin model has different phases, much richer phase diagram. And if we calculate the bipartite entanglement, then we find that there will be a high entanglement created in the paramagnetic two phases, which this phase is absent if you consider a quantum XY model. Quantum XY model has only PM1 or the paramagnetic 1 and antiferromagnetic phase. But due to this due to the interactions of the magnetic field that I have discussed, there is a new phase which comes to the picture. And that new phase contains high entanglement. And as I have shown that this entanglement is a resource. And so, this can be an important model for realizing quantum information processing tasks. Now I come to the dynamics of quantum spin model. Now, to build quantum technologies, dynamics also plays an important role, because to build a quantum computer, we actually have to realize, for example, there is something called one-way quantum computer. To realize that, one actually realizes when the spin models is evolving. Similarly, to transfer quantum state in long distance, that means a quantum communication protocol, also dynamics plays a role. So understanding evolution of quantum state are also important. So there is an important phenomena that was recently addressed by several scientists around the world, is called dynamical phase transition. As it is in the name, so it is observed in dynamics. Now, just like a quantum phase transition at zero temperature that I have discussed, there the phase transition is observed when we change the magnetic field. Here, the system changes its characteristics with time, and that's why it's called dynamical quantum phase transition. Now, if we consider, for example, XY spin model, suppose I start the evolutions with the ground state, which has a magnetic field, say lambda, which is H by J. Now I evolve the system according to other Hamiltonian, which is having the magnetic field lambda G1. It's a different magnetic field. And I choose these two parameters, G0 and G1, from different phases. That means different phases at zero temperature. So what people have found that if you consider the distance functions between this initial and final state, this time evolved state, and you consider a certain thing called rate function, this rate function can, if you consider the non-analyticity of rate functions with respect to time, that can detect dynamical phase transition. We know that non-analyticity of free energy with respect to temperature can indicate normal or thermal phase transitions that you people probably have learned in your statistical mechanics class. Now here we talk about a quantum mechanics where the non-analyticity of these rate functions, which is originated from the distance functions between the initial state and the final state, can show or can indicate dynamical quantum phase transition. Now this, although it's a new concept, but it has been already observed in experiment and by Iron Trap in 2017. Now, what we found in this ATXY model that I have discussed, that where the magnetic field I have changed, that we find that in this paper, we show that now in XY model, these critical times in which dynamical quantum phase transitions are observed are not uniformly spaced. So in the XY model, they are uniformly spaced. Although if you consider a alternating transverse field XY model, they are not uniformly spaced. This is the first result. Then we show that even if you do quenches, that means if my initial magnetic field is the PM2 phase of this point, and I change my magnetic field to the final state to be another PM2 phase, then still there will be a non-analyticity in the rate function, which is also not seen in case of XY model. And this is some peculiarity that we found in case of rate function and which indicates that we need more studies in this direction. Final thing that we show is the following, that if we call the multi-party entanglement measure, which I'm not going to discuss, but we find that the patterns of multi-party entanglement with time can help us to detect these dynamical quantum phase transitions. In particular, we find that if we have a dynamical phase transition, then multi-party entanglement show very high fluctuations. So for example, these are the three lines where we find that there is a dynamical phase transition. On the other hand, if we don't have dynamical phase transition, then the multi-party entanglement has a very low fluctuation. And to characterize these fluctuations, we consider actually the variation of time average or standard deviation of entanglement. And that clearly help us to detect dynamical phase transition. So with this, I actually come to the conclusion. So I show that if you have a XY model, and if you change magnetic field a little bit, so if you have a control in the system, then you can generate high entanglement in PM2 phase, which is important for quantum information processing tasks, because entanglement I have shown you to be a resource in quantum communication as well as certain quantum computational tasks. This is the static scenario, because this we only study when the system is at zero temperature. But if we go on to dynamics, then we show that there is something called dynamical quantum phase transition. And that phenomena can also be detected by using entanglement measure. So to summarize that, the quantum information quantities can help us to understand or to address fundamental properties or fundamental characterization of quantum spin model. At the same time, it helps us to build quantum technology. That aim of finding proper physical systems can also be proper physical systems for realizing quantum technologies can also be done via these studies. So this is the QIC group. There are some members which have already left, and some of them already are now faculties in different institutes in India, and many of them have left. New people have joined. Here, I just want to show that this is the women in science at HRI in 2017. And this is the current picture of women in science at HRI. And there are around 20 women, PhD, postdocs, visiting students, versus probably 120 members. So still there are a lot of disparity. And finally, I just want to thank you. This is a picture from a very nice effort of which there is a conference in Hyderabad in last September. So one of your coordinator was the organizer, and there are a lot of discussions and about how to change the picture. That means there are proper ratio between male and female scientists in physics. And this was really nice experience for me. So with that, I would like to thank you all for attention.
Thank you, Aditi, for a very, very stimulating lecture. And one of the reflection of good lecture is number of questions, and you have a lot of questions to answer from Zoom as well as YouTube. So I will first start with the Zoom question. And the first question is that how does the bits and dimensions interrelated?
Sorry, can you repeat once more?
How are the bits and dimensions interrelated?
Okay. Yeah, so the point is that, as I said, that when you want to send information, say in bits, then say, for example, a simple example which I can now think of, say probably today is very hot and it is not very hot. So this is the one bit of information. Now to send it, this information, you can use several methods. For simple methods, you can think of that if it is very hot, then I will send a red color flower. And if it is not hot, I will send a blue color flower. So I need two distinguishable objects to distinguish these two information. So these two distinguishable objects, I mean by two dimension. So here you see that I need, because one, so distinguishability I characterize by the dimension. And in this way, they are related.
And one more question in the related direction is that how do qubits pass the information?
How qubits pass the information? Yes, so Okay, so the point is that you perform certain certain operations on qubits, and then the change happens by which you can encode the information. So I again give you an example that, for example, if today is very hot and today is not very hot, the same example that I have told you. So suppose I have a state shared between Alice and Bob is singlet. So if Alice has a qubit, Bob has another qubit, and they are entangled. Now, Alice performs, say, unitary operations on her part, and say sigma x. And we know that sigma x flips the spin. So you will be able to create a state which is different from a singlet. You can do this in just in your paper and you will understand. And that may help you to encode two information. So whether it is hot or not hot. So in this way, qubit can help you. So manipulation in qubits via unitary operations or some valid quantum mechanical operations can help you to encode bits.
Okay. And one more question is this, how do the quantum computer system get itself in the initial state once used?
Okay, it depends on the system that we are talking about, because this is not, in general, we can talk like that. You know, where you are realizing and I mean, this is a bit more involved, I should say. So usually you can think that if you have an initial state, you are evolving. And on the evolution also, you go to certain states, you perform certain operations. In this way, you realize certain circuit. Just like a classical computer, you have a proper circuit. Then some protocols, this initialization is difficult. In some cases, you have to just build more and more qubit to be involved. So that you will be able to realize more and more gate operations, just like one-way quantum computer.
Okay. One more Zoom question is that, what is the difference between PM1 and PM2 phases in physical magnetism?
Yeah, so these actually I skip because I do not have time to discuss, but just one moment. Okay, somehow it hanged. So maybe I can just show you, because I have already the picture. Yes. So here, this is the PM2 phase. To detect PM2 phase, we actually calculate this operator. This is just because, you know, here the even and odd spin are different, having a different magnetic field. That means we have a magnetization is different in even and odd. If you calculate that, this MZE and MZO, you can think about a ZZ classical correlator as well. So in one phase, it is positive, and in another phase, it is negative. In this way, you can actually distinguish PM1 and PM2 phase. So the S physical quantity, if it is positive, then we conclude that it is PM1. And if it is negative, then it is a PM2 phase.
Okay. I'll be taking some YouTube questions now. And the first question is that, are quantum computers all about computing, or they can store information also?
It's computing, but it's okay. So the question, this is a nice question, because the it's not only computing, but how I present the results here, it's more like solving some mathematical problems, because this is a basic thing in quantum computer. But really, when we want to build quantum computers, we also want to store information, so we also expect that there should be a quantum memory. And but that these directions are more involved because that talks about a decoherence, robustness of quantum computer and so on. So I can tell you the details if you can, we can talk later.
So maybe whosoever asks the question can send this query to Aditi, and Aditi will be happy to answer that.
Exactly, exactly. Okay. I'll be very happy.
Okay. So the other question is that are the mixed states and entangled states same, and how are the entangled states generated?
Okay. So yeah, mixed state can also be entangled. So I also skipped this because I think I was out of time. So if you look that there is a definition that I have given, and in experiment, as I have told you that mostly we will not be, I mean, not mostly, I mean, we will never be able to create a pure entangled state, the definitions that I have given you. Rather, I will be able to create only the mixed states. So mixed entangled states, of course, exist. And one example that I have, for example, here, I showed you. So this is the singlet state is a mixed state. You can think that if the singlet state is admixed with a noise, so this depolarizing channel, you can think if singlets are sent to a depolarizing channel, then this state is created. Then these mixed states can be shown to be entangled for certain values of P. Now, how in general people create mixed states or mixed entangle or entangled states, as I have shown you, you can think there is a source and source create an entangled state. So for example, if you talk about photons, then usually there is a, in a parametric down conversion, there is a crystal in which you laser the pump and there are photons, two photons are emitted, which are in general entangled. And these photons, one photon is saying to say Alice, another is Bob. You can think that the source is in positions with one of them. Say Alice has the source. So Alice create an entangled state, keep one particle with him, with her, and another particle he sent through a noisy or noiseless channel. Of course, in experiments or in a reality, there will be a noisy channel to Bob. Finally, the state that is shared between Alice and Bob will be a mixed entangled state.
Okay, thanks Aditi. There's one more question is that what is the reason that Bob is not able to prepare the same state as Alice?
This I don't get it, but what I understand, I mean, Bob and Alice, I was always telling about Alice to Bob, but it's not that you can also start the protocol from Bob. I mean, there is no harm. So maybe I missed something, which I missed the...
I think it's in the reference to the beginning of your talk when you were showing that example. But still, if it is a confusion, maybe, you know, maybe I can request the person who asked the question to again write to Aditi with more detail.
Here I kind of, I set up the picture like that, that Alice is the sender and Bob is the receiver. So Alice is creating or Alice is sending information. Of course, in a scenario of a network or something, there Bob can also be a sender and Alice can be a receiver. So this there is nothing, but maybe I miss what person wants to ask. I mean,
maybe I encourage the person to talk to directly. Yeah, so there is an interesting question. Is that, is there any case where classical information is more relevant than the quantum information?
Here actually what we want to see that, you know, that still we believe that there will be a classical information transmission by using quantum state or classical informations which will be encoded in a quantum state. So in some sense, here the manipulations of classical information as well as quantum information are happening. So if we really want to build a quantum computer or quantum protocols, there probably both will be involved. So as we know that in quantum teleportations where we want to transfer quantum state, so that's also an interesting point. Although I haven't described properly the protocol. So for example, the quantum teleportations that I have described here, as you see, that Alice and Bob share a quantum state, which is now you know that this is an entangled state. And to send this arbitrary quantum state, Alice also needs 2 bits of classical information. Without these 2 bits of classical communication, Alice will never be able to send an arbitrary quantum state to Bob. So that's an important point. So this is kind of the junctions of the quantum mechanics as well as classical information theory. Both are in use. So I really don't know how to compare, but in some protocol, Alice to Bob, the classical information transmission is prohibited. Or in some scenario, this is allowed and so on.
Okay. So I think in the interest of time, we will end now. And there are some more stimulating questions on YouTube as well as Zoom. And I really, really thank Aditi for such an exciting talk and all the people who listened to the lectures and asked such interesting questions. And all I want to say to you all is that don't feel disheartened. Aditi is very much willing to answer your questions. Please reach out to her and ask your queries. And I, my apologies that I could not take all the questions. And I really thank Aditi for the lecture and all the participants for attending the talk. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you very much. And really, I will be happy to answer any questions. Please send me an email. I can also write in a chat box my email, or I think that can be circulated also.
We will make it available on the Moodle.
Yeah, so that anybody can ask me any question for clarification. It's really nice that I was able to involve in this nice organization, and thank you all of you for making this happen.
Thank you, Aditi. Thank you so much.
A lot of young minds, Aditi. You are inspiring a lot of people. Thanks to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Aditi. Thank you, Poonam, for hosting the session. And yes, actually, if you go to the HRI webpage also, Aditi's address is available, but we will make it available to you so that you can contact her. Yes. Thank you so much for participating in the program.
Thanks.
Thank you.